Welcome, welcome to the wind apocalypse. And you may hear it during this video, it's just been extremely boisterous today. High wind warning. Stuff just flying everywhere. Nice way to end, come close to ending 214, right? Nice segue into 215, which may be the real apocalypse. Collapse into compliance, which is almost like a silent collapse, like nobody really says much of anything. It's just like you go when your mouth goes beneath the quicksand in quiet. So hopefully everyone is doing well. I've been having a very difficult time, and I said the first order of business is don't retreat. Well, I sort of got into trouble retreating a little bit. Made some graphics, some really incredibly beautiful graphics, and then I said, well, maybe I can make this into a video, and I started to get, before you know it, I'm on a slippery slope. Unfortunately, nothing worked properly. No matter what I did, I couldn't render properly. I was wasting a lot of time. I said, well, this is shades of the old days where I was, you know, wasted time. So I said, forget it. That's you know, that's backsliding. And so first order of business is don't backslide. So I cut it short, said no, okay. And am just continuing this full stop in the wow, which is very intense now. So intense I feel extremely tired, like inside, like almost like collapsing is so difficult. Because just standing up against the current of the cosmic corporate culture, the CCC, just standing against that current, it just, you know, exhausts you, because everyone seems to be more or less oblivious here. So it's like, so it doesn't even exist what's going on. It's not even, it's like, it's kind of like in a dream where you know, you don't really know what's next, right? It just, stuff keeps happening to you, and the world seems like a dream. It seems like all this stuff's just happening, and it's just the way it happens. You don't even put two and two together. But if you're waking up in the dream, you say, hey, wait a minute. I see these trends. I see where it's going. What is this about? You know, and then you start realizing how the dream is going to go, and you know what its purpose is, where it's taking you. It's you know, mockery. The existence is mockery of God, of reality. We're mocking God in reality here. And this is a very useful tool to use, is to look at it as mockery. And then what I've been able to do is realize so many different stances the world takes. It's mockery. So much. And it's like, wow, recognizing that, then you realize that the questioning or what the pressure they put on you is just another form of mockery. To think that we are bodies in this determinate world of nature, born to die, and all this is just the most absurd mockery of reality. We think that stuff can happen to us is the most absurd mockery of reality. Of I am spirit, I am free, I am still exactly as God created me. So as we go into this new year, soon to go into a new year, 215, may very well be the apocalyptic year in terms of people just no longer able to resist the entropy of the CCC. It's very entropic. Of course, it defines itself as progressive, but it's actually extraordinarily a mocking of reality. So it's very entropic. Designed to collapse us into deeper into a dreaming state, like a coma, where we're not even aware we're in the dreaming state at all. We're not even aware we're just imagining all this. We just take it for the dream is real. You know, that's what they're about. So, you know, waking up from the dream, you find all this mockery, you know, pulling you down, pulling you down, pulling you down. And today I was able to get the answers from the Holy Spirit as to what do you say in this, what do you say, what do you say in this? And I was able to get it, but can I remember it off the spur of the moment? Not quite yet. It's just, it may, any moment I may just click and just have the right responses. But it was certainly great to just to hear that it's, we're capable of addressing all the strategies that mockery uses to pull you down, to mock you, and to not be mocked by it, and not get caught up in guilt traps and all this kind of stuff. It was great to experience that. So I know it is possible. I know it is possible. We live our whole lives feeling oppressed by something that we can't quite stand up to it, and then to realize that it is possible to stand up to the demands of mockery and say no, it is possible. So, but it takes this full stop. It takes a full stop in the wow of all this. Full stop in the wow. So I realize it is possible. Now this is a wow. And if I don't recognize it as a wow, it will go into entropy, some sort of entropic feeling of fatigue and anxiety and hopelessness. Where if you just realize that your progress actually brings about this, wow, I can do it. You know, what is the reaction to say, wow, I can do this? Well, is this wow, like you just say, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. But what happens is we slip back into the dream and forget that we're in this condition of feeling like, oh my gosh, this is such great, fantastic news. I don't even know what to do about it. We don't monitor that and honor it and recognize it. This is the whole key problem to this world, to the struggles to awaken from the dream. And the struggle for all is this continuity issue. And the better we're able to recognize and flip it and say, no, I'm in a wow mode. I'm not in a fatigue mode. I'm in a wow mode, but it's exhausting for me because the news is so great. This is the pivot. This is what the whole path, spiritual path, pivots on. Is keeps full stop in the wow. Recognize the wow. And I've done this during the daytime. I was feeling super depressed and tired. Say, I'm failing. And then I said, wait a minute, no. This is wow. I'm in extreme wowism as well. I'm in an extreme wowistic mood because I'm realizing, hey, I can do it. So isn't that interesting? That right when we're right at the verge of success, that's when we feel most likely we're going to fail. Why? Because the wow is so extreme, we misinterpret it and think that it means that, oh wow, I'm going to fail. Look at this, the feeling I feel, like I can't function, I can't do it. So, as they say, it's always darkest before the dawn. This is a very important aphorism, or whatever you want to call it. What is it, this little aphorism, idiom, aphorism? It's always darkest before the dawn. This is why. When we see the dawn, say, oh, it is dawning. You know, it is dawning. Oh, the light is coming. I'm going to be out of this darkness. And it's just like, it almost overwhelms you. And then you almost sink into apathy and listlessness and, you know, non-functionality because you're so overwhelmed with feeling this is so great. I'm finally, after this long, freezing, cold, dark night, the sun is going to arise. It's going to rise, you know. If you don't recognize that properly, then you will think, oh, I'm doomed. You know, I'm doomed. I'm going to succumb to all the troubles. I can't make it. And this is the problem. So just to advance upon the spiritual path, one has to continually recognize this. Otherwise, you'll give up. You'll misinterpret the success you're having as failure. You see is how tricky that is. And this hit me again. It always hits us. Because it takes such extraordinary patience. Because the wow remains there, you know, it just doesn't go away so quickly. And so I'm in this perpetual state of wow now, because I'm getting so close, and I'm realizing this, and it just, you know, it's just so great to know this, that it's overwhelming. So we may approach this, the answer, quite a few times, but so overwhelmed by it, we tend to slide back into sleep. It's like someone waking up from a dream. They're so happy to awake from the dream, it overwhelms them, and they fall back asleep. It's really like that. It's like, oh, I'm awake, that is so great. It's like, oh, I can't even move, I'm so happy to be awake, and then you don't move, and then just, oh. Drowsiness hits you before you know you're back asleep again. And then you're not even sure what happened. And everything seems to be happening to you then. So, what's important is when we start to wake up, we stay calm and just say, okay, so I'm starting to wake up. Okay, that's good. And don't overreact to success. This is the practice. It may seem paradoxical, but the practice is really to not overreact to success. The success we all need is within us, and the success is that I've never been a body, I've always been complete. I've never needed nature to feel inherently sweet. You know, the inherent sweetness of bliss. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I don't really need nature to feel. I don't need nature at all. I really don't need nature to feel inherently sweet. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I don't need nature to feel inherently sweet. And this is what is coming for me. I realize I don't need nature at all. I don't need anything in terms of any specificness, in terms of anything specific. I don't need anything specific at all. That doesn't mean that we're not experiencing. It's just that there's no feeling necessity for anything to be specific in order for any need of completeness at all. No. And the way that nature is just, it's a play that we have our imagination that makes it seem like it's, you get all of this. You know, you can't get part of nature really. It's right. It's all of it. you think you need it? Then you get this feeling like you must need this. You don't need it at all. I've never been a body. I've never been born. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. There's never been any incompleteness in what we are at all. Never. That's like saying, for example, how can pure spaciousness be incomplete as pure spaciousness? Does the appearance of things, appearances in pure spaciousness make pure spaciousness feel incomplete? Incomplete? No. So, I've always been complete, okay? I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I really, really don't need nature in order to feel super sweet. Feels super sweet. I remember when I had the awakening back in 1978, I felt suffused with this super sweetness. I didn't know where it was coming from. My whole body, I just felt like my whole body, like it turned into honey or something. It was super sweet. Hasn't happened since then. This was an emergence of the God of God within me, of the divine, of completeness within me. It emerged for a brief time. Just and that emergence resulted in awakening and recognizing delusion for the situation where we, the delusion that was, you know, baffling us, and it came with a super sweetness. So I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I really don't need nature to feel intrinsically sweet. To feel intrinsically sweet. To feel inherently sweet. To feel causelessly sweet. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I really don't need nature to feel causelessly sweet. To feel the causeless. To feel causelessly sweet. I am causelessly sweet. Causeless sweetness. Inherent, intrinsic, inherent, causeless sweetness. So nature has absolutely nothing to do with my being complete. Absolutely not even the tiniest shred. It has zero to do, and will always have absolutely zero to do with completeness. So to the extent that we look upon nature as something that completes us, it's utterly meaningless in this way. Total delusion. Just delusion, delusion, delusion. Now, let's say, for example, when I was a kid, I used to use a baseball bat to play baseball all the time. And now I don't play baseball anymore. But let's say you have that bat. What do you mean? You put it in the closet, you put it up on the wall or something, and you say, this is nice memories, or, and I don't want to throw it out. Yeah, it's okay. So it's like something that you used to use when you're younger and you don't need it anymore. Maybe a baseball mitt. You don't play catch anymore, but you still keep the mitt. You have it somewhere. Or whatever it is with you. So this world, you realize, I don't need it anymore. In fact, I never needed it. I thought I did, but I never needed it. In fact, no one needs it. What do you do? Do you like immediately, you know, throw it in the shredder or something? You say, no. Put it on the wall, put it in the closet, just, you know, let it, you don't need it. Like your bicycle you used to ride, maybe you put it in the shed or something, you're not riding it, you know, don't need to ride it anymore, or what, something like that. So, we don't have to, again, don't have to get rid of nature that way. You just realize you don't need it at all to complete what you are. See, nature is this picture of ceaseless completion, is it not? Working on completion, giving rise to forms, incompleteness, let me, brings into fuller form, you know, and it gives right, and then. It seems to be, you know, everything, you might also say in nature is like ceaselessly incomplete, right? Both complete and incomplete, but the bottom line is, we are complete. Why? For perfect freedom. What is it that can make perfect freedom incomplete? There isn't anything. There's no experience can do that because we're free to have any other experience. So, I have never been a body. I've always been complete. I really don't need even a speck of nature in order to feel inherently sweet. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I really don't need even a tiny speck of nature in order to feel inherently sweet. It was interesting. The wind was raging, and I dozed off. And I suddenly woke up and opened my eyes and looked out the window, and everything was absolutely still. Not a leaf was even moving. I just stayed that way as long as I was looking at it. I said, wow. One moment you have this tempestuousness, and the next moment, and look, suddenly it's just absolutely still. Which means Managing our success means we are succeeding. And the good tidings, the glad tidings of that success are so enormous, just off the wall, off the charts, right? I don't need even a speck of nature. I have never needed even a speck of nature. How great a news is that? After this long, long pretended bondage, this to nature, this terrible bully that we have fashioned, that has been screaming at us that we need it to be complete. We need to put go through all these processes, do all this stuff, work on all this, and to feel that you've been enslaved by nature for so long. Really, a dream of enslavement is really a dream of mockery. We've been mocking ourselves and believing in the mockery. You know, that's the problem with mockery, is in order to keep doing it, you someone walking. The wind was so strong, it made it seem like blowing everything around. Now, when in order to keep mocking, you have to believe that the mockery is accurate. You have to believe that it's true. Otherwise, why would you be mocking? So we believe our own mockery. It's self-mockery. We've been mocking ourselves, saying we're terrible, we're stupid, we're incompetent, we deserve nothing but the slavery. You know, we're incomplete. We've been believing this nonsense. So it's very difficult to let it go. Wow, it is just wild, wild out here. Nice omen for 2:15, isn't it? So to find out that our mockery is completely unfounded is a shock. Because after a while we start believing our own mockery and thinking, no, we're not mocking, we're just telling it like it is. We believe that of course we look at nature and think that nature, we're a product of nature, and then of course we think, no, we're just a flesh, impermanent flesh, and struggling to reach higher potentials. And all this mockery, we think that it's real. We start believing our own mockery, that it's just real, and then we don't even realize it is mockery. This silly game we're playing, we take it seriously. We take it seriously. We say, this is what we are. This is what we are. So, of course, it's a shock when we say, hey, wait, I've never been a body. Never been a body. I've never been a body. Just because there's an idea in spirit to express, so it moves the tongue and the mouth like this and pushes air out and says, I have never been a body, I have never been a body, I have never been a body. But just using the speech mechanism doesn't mean that I am a body. It doesn't mean that's what I am. It doesn't mean the completeness is a body. No, completeness isn't any specific thing at all. The absolute freedom is not any thing specific. It's not a thing. It can never be defined. It can never be defined in any way. So I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I really don't need even a tiny speck of nature in order to feel intrinsically sweet. Been complete. I don't even need a speck of nature to feel inherently sweet, feel causelessly sweet, intrinsically, super sweet, super sweet. We're all looking for that feeling of sweetness, somehow to feel sweet instead of the way we feel achy and irritated. tired and stuff. Just this sweetness. So full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. The key to success is, again, what? Recognizing the wow of the progress. I mean, just put two and two together. We're saying, I've never been a body, wow. I've always been complete, wow. I really don't need even a speck of nature. To feel the intrinsic bliss, sweetness, sweet bliss of reality. And we are consciously stating this, wow, and saying this is the facts, these are the facts. So we're saying how I feel is not dependent on nature in the slightest bit, not even the tiniest bit. Am I dependent upon nature for how I feel? For my state of mind? For my completeness? We don't even have really a state of mind. We're complete. That completeness doesn't change. The completeness, it does not change. So you might say this, the completeness is the stillness, right? It's nothing being completed, so it's absolute stillness. There's no sense of, there's nothing being added or subtracted to make it still. So it's just, it's an inherent stillness of completeness. And don't analyze it too much. Just say, wow, okay, I just glimpsed it. I just, okay, wow, that's great. So with all practice periods, we're working to bring up this greater and greater wow, feeling the sheer attractiveness of our home, of our true nature, which is this completeness, this effortless completeness. It's not searching to complete itself. It's not struggling to complete itself. It's not trying to come to any conclusion. So from the standpoint of struggle, of trying to, of becoming, our true nature seems as though it's absolute still silence. In that regard. And that's the regard that we're most attuned to, is action, effort, searching, trying, becoming, you know, trying to complete this and that. And so, we look at it from that perspective, and then we see it's absolutely no effort at all. Meaning, the effort is still. If we look at it, we'd say, well, that's absolute stillness. Absolute stillness of effort. No effort is taking place. So this is what we're supposed to be focused on and feeling. Many have reached this, and we're supposed to reach it. So we don't make too big of a deal about it. We try to keep our reactions, limited. Not by failure to advance, but advancing with poise, full stop poise. As far as having to clean up this area here, this big area. It's like, yeah, it's gonna get gone again in the morning. It's just absolutely trashed. So this wind's just knocking everything down. Huh, interesting. It's like a tree where all the fruit is well, all the seeds, seed pods or something, or the wind, you know, hits them and they all drop. They can't, the wind's too strong for them, knocks them down. The world is like that. There's so many people here who have been termited through the efforts of the CCC. So when the wind starts blowing real strong, they just, you know, they collapse. Can't stay on the tree of truth. Can't remain attached to the tree of truth. And this is what's coming. This is what's coming. So, what's helpful? Silence, stillness, seeing the inner silence, recognizing the inner silence, being in the inner silence, that would be helpful, for sure. So, but we need some boost going into 215, some sort of boost going into 215. Now again, just don't retreat during this time, just don't retreat. Okay, so I'm helping with this. I understand right now could be a very powerful urge to collapse and retreat. And all the habits that you have, is what's the use, you know? I'm like trying, being on a diet, battling this, not getting anywhere. You know, it's been battling and battling almost a month, really hardly getting anywhere, just can't see. But, you know, I just said, no, let me just keep staying with them. I don't want to, I feel like, what's the use, you know? Why do I suffer? Let's just eat everything we want to eat and heck with it and give up. There's the mood, it's like a mood, like, why don't I just give up? Said, well, you know, I like the challenge. It's interesting. You know, can I do this? Can I do it? Can I keep, you know, can I stay attached to truth? It seems a way of making this whole situation worthwhile is this. You know, why just, you know, collapse into compliance? Which is really just deciding to mock truth, to mock reality, to mock life, mock God, mock spirit, mock reason. Deciding is to be a mocker. Dream I had, I was shown what's going to happen, this huge collapse of rocks. And you know, well, it was portrayed that way, but it could be related to mocking. A massive collapse into mockery. We're right on the cusp of it right now. It's been set up, we've all been termited to such an extent. Weakened, our resistance weakened. It's like this, you know, I tell you how nature works. It works in very devious ways. And it'll first weaken your resistance, like, you know, drought hits a forest land area. What happens? The beetles come in then. The beetles come in, they bore into the trees. The fungus is on the beetles, and it kills all the trees. Pretty interesting, right? How? Then the CCC came to this world, and setting up a spiritual drought here in this world for some time, getting us more and more focused on materialism. And who came along? The beetles came along. And what hitched a ride on the beetles? Well, the drug culture, pop culture, a lot of stuff hitched a ride on the beetles and got into our psyche. A whole sort of attitude. And now we have a forest of dead trees, so to speak. Which, what happens? Forest fire comes along. Right? So you see how nature is so devious, nature. And you know, I'm not mocking. When I laugh, I'm not mocking. I'm this is an important issue. Very important issue. because I found that what pulled me down is in the resistance to mockery. People said I was mocking mockery, and then I felt guilty. I said, "Oh, I'm mocking too. That's terrible," you know. So this is a very crucial area. What we're doing is we're laughing in delight that the mockery isn't true, you see, and so that's what it is. We're happy that it's not true. It's not mocking the mockery. We don't have a need to be negative in that way. We're saying, look at all these booze we're trying to, all this stuff, and I see that's just a silly mockery. it's a relief, laughing in relief, laughing in great relief, like, this isn't true. This isn't true. The deviousness. I don't need nature at all, but drought, the beetles come in, they bore in the tree, the fungus gets inside, the trees dry up, they become, you know, dry. And then someone lights a match, and then wildfire, smoke, the whole forest gone, like that, quickly. Doesn't take a wildfire very long to get going. So we have to understand that humans, the humans, beings, what we call human beings, are like trees, like anything else in this world. This is just a product of nature. The body is just a product of nature. And the way that nature works with all this is very devious. So you might say that the world is full of light. It's a forest of like dead trees right now, spiritually dead trees. And therefore it doesn't take, all it takes is a match to get it going. And the wildfire sweeps across the whole planet because no one has any resistance anymore. You know, trees that are really healthy, full of water, you know, you can't really burn a forest like that down. It doesn't work, right? It doesn't work. They're not very flammable. But you get the trees that are super dried out, and that's a different story. So I would say, what's happened in the world is we've become spiritually dry, very spiritually dry. I've tried to stay hydrated, spiritually hydrated. So, you know, have some immunity to this situation. So keep in mind that this, imagine a spiritually dry planet. There's been a spiritual drought on this planet. Very bad drought here. It's like the monsoons have not come. The spiritual monsoons, you know, have not come. The last really strong monsoon, I don't know. It is getting less and less, but you had some in the 20th century. But it's been since the mid-70s, things have dried out very badly, like a drought. There might be in a few, a little bit of rain, you know. But spiritually, we've been in a severe drought. Severe drought, monsoon has not come. So we're all famished, spiritually dried out, super low resistance to pressure, to mockery, to falling into an attitude of mockery. The attitude of mockery is everywhere now in this world. It is everywhere. It's like night and day, the way that people relate now, how they express themselves, and how it used to be when, like in the, earlier in the 20th century, but people were not, they weren't so full of mockery, you know, nastiness and all this kind of stuff. They're much sweeter, actually. I remember that the older people, generation, they seemed so sweet to me. I said, how can you be so sweet? That's amazing. For them, it was just normal. This is the life they led. But to us, when we started to get pulled into mockery, it seemed like, oh, they're so sweet, it's amazing. They were in touch with their spirit. They weren't in such a spiritual drought. They were a little bit, you know, they had some hydration, spiritual hydration from within, trying to live a virtuous life and a disciplined, prayerful, virtuous life, good habits, spiritual habits, you know, a lot of focus on trying to commune with God. And bring a certain sweetness to you. And so now, where do you go for that? Where do you find that sort of sweetness just as a general, you know, attitude among people in the way? No, No, people are dry, they're brittle. One thing you can realize is how brittle people are now to any sort of PC dry, and how brittle, spiritually brittle the world is. So easily insulted, so easily to take offense. Look, you know, just the slightest thing, they just fly off the handle and hey, call the Twitter brigade. Let's crush this. This is irritating to me. It didn't used to be that way. It took a lot to get people angry in the past. I mean, you just could not. Now it takes virtually nothing. And people are frantically apologizing. Oh my gosh, I said something, someone got mad. Oh my gosh, this is horrible. You know, it's gonna start a conflagration, you know. So this is what happens when we get spiritually dry and brittle. It is the littlest thing will cause us to snap. The littlest thing will cause us to snap. As we are seeing in our culture. I mean, the stuff that happens in the world, the way the world is, you're always having all these troubles. It's an attitude of mockery, severe mockery, in trying to bring about situations that prove how vulnerable we are, and prove how worthless we are, and prove how, you know, how nothing we are, and prove that we're not eternal, and prove it. This is all mockery. So there's so many patterns of mockery going that we have fashioned into this nature, into this world. These are all patterns of mockery, self-mockery. And so they're playing, they're playing in every which way with the world, in all these patterns, with all this fear and projection, and thinking that other people are trying to put us down, and, you know, and projection. Oh, you know, it's just a nightmare, an absolute cesspool of fear and confusion. So, of course, all sorts of stuff happens. People react and get angry and think, you know, someone told me today that since in Mexico, since Christmas, this is a few days, in just one state in Mexico, there have been X number of homicides. I mean, it's a huge number, an incredible number. Just people just going crazy, shooting each other. And, you know, just people are just like nuts, and it's so brittle, right? Those who pay attention to spirit know, turn the other cheek, love your enemy, agree with your adversary, be very slow to anger, don't anger at all, just forgive the situation, forgive. And so this creates a better sweetness in society this way, absolutely it does. And that creates a positive feedback loop. So when I say 2:15, look out, the next 18 months, I mean that the world has now become so brittle, that a conflagration in some way, a collapse in the compliance in some way, you know, it could just be people say, wow, you know what? Everybody's so on edge, everybody's so brittle, everybody's so fragile. We really need to avoid a conflagration by everybody collapsing into compliance. We'll agree upon all these restrictions upon our speech, our thinking, our beliefs, our expressions, our actions, etc., 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 etc. In other words, we'll come into full compliance with the CCC, because the CCC tells us that they have the means to get us all on the same page. And we think in our lack of, because we mocked our thinking, we're using a thinking which isn't really thinking, a reason, it's not really reason, it's a mockery of reason. And we just believe if we're all on the same page that everything will be fine. Even if that same page is self-mockery. We think if everyone is engaged in self-mockery, then everything will be fine, magically fine. We'll be happy. This is again a mockery of reason, isn't it? So as we mock reason, we then end up using mock reason, you know, but not true reason at all, which leads us to this bizarre conclusions. And we become very vulnerable to madness on a grand scale, grandiosity. Say, let's everybody equally mock us what we are. And this becomes a new world religion, is really mockery, self-mockery. This is what we're going towards. Is the new world religion of self-mockery that everybody has to say, no, I am a body. You know, that, what could be more mocking ourselves, which is pure essence, pure idea in the mind of God, pure freedom, absolute pure freedom. To claim that this is what it really is this human body. You know, that is just the most ridiculous, humorous thing ever, right? And we have to laugh at it. And yet that is, you know, that's the height of self-mockery. And that what we are is subject to being annihilated no more. You know, saying eternal life, eternal freedom, pure freedom is no more, you know, no more. Not only is it a body, but then the body collapses and it's gone forever. This is, you know, hilarious, very hilarious. You know, just like an absurd jest. That's why it's laughable, an absurd jest. Have to laugh at absurd jests, don't take them seriously. So, this new world religion that is coming, and to collapse into it in some way, either through just the world just be, you know, what I see is possible is the world just feeling so brittle, and everyone starts, you know, tweeting, hey, you know what, everybody? Do you feel this way? I feel like really easily snap. I'll easily snap. People said, yeah, me too. And then we'll kind of, someone will come up and say, hey, you know what, everybody, the world, some false messiah will come along and say, hey, you know what? You know, we're inherently fragile beings. They'll say, we have this inherently fragile ecosystem, inherently fragile beings. This is what we are. And you know what? We have the RX for that. And we need to, you know, engage in collective self-mockery. And if we all, and the answer is, they'll say, the answer is everybody do this. You know, power in total consensus. As if truth is at the mercy of consensus, of lies. You know, everyone believing lies, that means the lies must be what make us happy. That reality loses attraction to us, that we're no longer what we are. That, you know, that's all magical belief. It's just magical belief. So, magical belief to those who are really dried out spiritually seems like a panacea. It seems like a panacea. And they don't have any resistance to it, is the problem. Just like a dried out forest doesn't have any resistance to wildfire. It's interesting, I was born right next to a huge grove of redwood trees. And redwood trees have resistance to wildfire, no matter what. You know that? You can't burn up a redwood tree really because their bark, you know, they have this enormous resistance, which is why they're so old. This forest burns down around and burns down over, you know, they become what, thousands of years old, these redwood trees. And you can see where the fire tried to get to them, but no, they're resistant to it. Interesting. So, I've sort of had this resistance to this wildfire of self-mockery, compliance. But the world doesn't, I look at the world, I say, hey, there's not a lot of people out there like this, you know, like me. There's some, to some, you know, very extent of some resistance, and they're feeling the heat right now, for sure. And it's like, you know, living in this world is like living in like a cabin. It's like living in a forest, and it's all dry. And of course you get nervous, you say, holy cow, it takes us a spark and this whole forest is going to go up. And this is not the most secure thing, you know, living in this world at this time. Now if you're a redwood tree, you say, well, you know, I can't burn down, but, you know, you get an intense enough fire and you're going to do damage to the redwood tree. You can do some damage. It might survive, but it's not like it's saying, hey, this is what I like, you know? The smoke, if it's really bad enough, you know, it can even hurt a redwood tree. I mean, redwood trees have a lot of resistance, but, you know, stuff eventually can get to them. So, certainly don't want to go through that situation. PC wildfire. Absolute PC wildfire is what we're headed for. PC wildfire. The world's been conditioned to collapse into magical belief, and magical belief always tends to go towards saying, hey, we need everybody to be on the same page. Let's all think alike. And what we're thinking, and the thinking alike means self-mockery. Self-mockery. Where these bodies, spirit doesn't exist. Where these bodies, spirit doesn't exist. Like in communist China, a perfect example of you know, totally atheistic, you know, vicious against those who believe in spirit. And they say everybody has to believe this way. No one, you know, we can't leave any stone unturned. It has to be 100% compliance. Those who don't believe, re-education. Send breaking rocks out in the Taklamakan Desert. Doing service for the people. Serving the people. Yeah. That's what happens. So they want 100% compliance. This is called magical belief, magical thinking of those who are in such a severe continuity fear, they don't even recognize it. They can't even recognize it. They believe their own mockery, self-mockery. They believe that it's true. And so the last thing they want to do is be spirit, because they're spending a lot of time mocking spirit, saying, spirit, you're nothing, you're terrible, you're evil, you're wrong. And so they believe that, so of course they don't want to go back, accept that they're spirit. They say, heck no, that's terrible, spirit's terrible. So the body's great, the body's good, I want to be a body, that's what I want to be. And they say, yeah. And so they believe the answer to happiness, the answer to this fragility that we have is let's all agree. See, the idea of if we all agree, then nobody's saying anything to make a snap. Nobody's saying, hey, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. Nobody's saying that, you can't have that, and I'll snap. So, magical thinking believes that if we all believe that lies are better than truth, then lies will be better than truth, of course. We believe that. We've all believed that if we all believe that self-mockery is better than if mocking ourselves is better than ourselves, then we think that it will be. If we all believe this, it will be better. Then it will be better than ourselves. Magical belief, as if somehow reality is at the mercy of our definitions and our consensus and our agreements, and saying, you know what? If we just agree that reality doesn't exist, then it doesn't exist. This is magical belief. And this is what the CCC brings. This is what the world collapsing into compliance with magical belief, meaning mockery of reason. That's why it's so difficult to keep reason, awareness of reason in this world now. That's why I'm exhausted. It's so difficult. Because the attitude of mockery is off the charts. So clearly, I have to make some sort of shift, even beyond reason, you know, even beyond that, to even deeper citadel, you know. I need an even deeper citadel at this time, for sure, we do. Reason is a great fortress, but even a great fortress can be stormed. So we need an invincible citadel, actually, at this point. We need an invincible citadel. And that's what I will retreat to, that invincible citadel. That's what I'm determined to do so. And of course, magical belief won't like that one bit. We get them on the same page. Typical. Can't do it. And we know when trees burn, they turn into torches. It's horrible, right? We have so many wildfires here in California. We are all very accustomed to seeing on the news, or whatever, you know, these gigantic conflagrations that just. The eucalyptus trees here go up like these massive torches. Nothing like a dry eucalyptus forest to make people feel jittery. And we have certainly have those now. Fortunately, we did get a little rain in December, but still, a lot of eucalyptus trees are very, very dry. And so the world, seeing everybody go up like a torch, you know, just to go. But the thing is, that although I'll think that this is, they're celebrating happiness. This is like, they suddenly got religion. So what will happen in the world is the world will suddenly feel like, hey, we all finally got religion. We're all agreeing that we need, that magical belief is the answer. If we all just decide that you know, to mock ourselves, then that's the answer. We'll all be happy. We'll all be satisfied. We'll enter a golden age of self-mockery. And so they don't see it like they're collapsing. They don't see it like they're like burning up with agitation. They think that this is they're entering into the new dispensationalism. They're on fire with magical belief. And you see these riots, these crowds, these agitators, you know, they feel like they're on fire with righteousness, and you know, and this, you know, more and more and more people are being gripped by this, and they're telling the police, hey, stay out of our way, you know, because we're righteous, we're burning with a righteous fire here. You know, we're going to get everybody to pull everybody down into mockery of reason, mockery of truth, you know, say, hey, everybody. We are all bodies. We're all human beings. This is our home, and this is all there is. And anyone who says differently is crazy. Again, this is just abject mockery. That's all it is. But it can seem like a powerful movement when everyone agrees in this world. It seems like, wow, you know, like something's happening. Well, we've had many situations where a lot of people have agreed. Well, nothing's happened. I mean, the world is same old mockery of reality. Inherently so, this world. You know, so, magical belief doesn't work. Magical belief doesn't work. I have never been born. I've never had a body. I've always been complete. I don't need anything from nature in order to feel totally sweet. Totally sweet. Okay, that's powerful. I have never, ever been born. You can say that. I have never, ever been born. I've always been perfectly complete. I don't need any bit of nature. I don't need any bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. I have never been born. I've always been complete. I don't need even a tiny bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. I have never been born. I've always been complete. I don't need even a bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. Now rinse and repeat. Every time we do an affirmation, it rinses some of the continuity fear off, some of the self-mockery. It rinses it off. That's what it is. How is you going to get out of self-mockery except turning the tables and saying the truth about yourself? How else can you do it? You know, when we say I've been born, we're totally mocking what we are. When we say we're incomplete, we're totally mocking what we are. When we accept that we need nature to, you know, for some reason, we're totally mocking what we are. When we are not feeling totally sweet, we're totally mocking what we are. So how do we turn that around and say, hey, I have never been born. I have always been perfectly complete. I don't need even a bit, I don't need one bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. In order to feel totally sweet. And just keep saying it, rinse and repeat. I have never, ever been born. I have never, ever been born. I've always been perfectly complete. I don't need one bit of nature. nature in order to feel totally sweet. I don't need one bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. So this is the power of these affirmations that we use here, and I call wowism, because that is the reaction. This is what we have to be aware of. We have to be aware of the wow that these practices bring up in us. If not, we'll think we're failing, and we'll quit. Because what happens is we're stunned, because here we've been mocking ourselves, and we thought we have no power. We've been mocking our own power, so we don't have any power to stop mocking, which is, again, more mockery, isn't it? Mockery compounds itself. So now here we have the power to say, hey, I have never, ever been born. I've always been perfectly complete. I don't need one bit of nature to feel totally sweet. Now rinse and repeat, you see. It's like, oh my gosh. For eons, I've been believing I don't have the power to say that, to do this. I don't have the power to break, to stop the mockery. And now here I am stopping it, you see, in its tracks. So of course, this brings about just an enormous wow. I didn't know I could do this. Just wow. And on a little scale, like maybe there's something in this world we thought we could never do. And trying to get a lid off of a can, a little like a lid off of a bottle that's, you know, we had a bottle like that recently, and it was like so difficult. I couldn't do it. I just like, wow. I said, uh-oh. My strength, I used to be, you know, have strong hands. Again, I'm getting old. This is terrible. So, but I said, you know what? I'm not going to give up. I'm going to get this. And a couple of bursts, finally, poof, popped it. You know, it's like, wow. Wow. I did it. You know, wow, I did it. I still have some strength. And that's just a tiny idea of, you're thinking like there's something really difficult, I don't think I can do it, and then you do it. And you say, holy cow. Because the ramifications, of course, are just the reason why it's such a big wow is I don't need a bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. I don't need even a bit of nature in order to feel totally sweet. So, this is just like, oh my gosh. That means I can feel totally sweet right now, yeah. I mean, I don't need anything to happen at all. Anything, any happening. We call nature happenings. Anything to happen. I don't need any dynamic. Don't need any appearances. I don't need anything in order to feel totally sweet. I inherently feel that way, see? So this reverberates into this, you know, great rejoicing that it's just wow. Can I even hold, you know, can I even deal with this? How do I abide in this? It's so great. So we call it wowism. Wowism. Wowism, because we are focused, full stop in the wow. I redid the website a little bit. It's up there. There's a link to it on the on my channel page. Actually, I need to put the link up. Probably should be up there by the time this video is here. Yeah. There's many ways to express it. Many ways. Different ways to express it. So, you know, you can always rewrite. But basically, I say, what is wow? Practice. Have to. We've been stuck in this self-mocking for so long, we have to begin to realize we can get out of it. We have to say, I've never been born. To say I've been born is utter self-mockery. I have never been a body. To say we're bodies is utter self-mockery of what we are. I've always been complete. To say that we've somehow not been complete is total self-mockery. Okay, so I've always been complete. I don't need a bit of nature to feel totally sweet, right? To say that we need something from nature to feel inherently how we feel, the inherentness of reality, the completeness. What's the feeling of completeness? To say that we need nature to make us feel the way completeness feels is total self-mockery. Okay? So, practice, practice, practice. And what does practice bring about? Wow. He says, you know, I'm succeeding. This is fantastic. This is... And then if you have to be aware of this and stay calm, it hits everybody. I mean, just I had so much success a couple days ago that I actually started getting a little hyper, and then the wheels started coming off and started backsliding. And yeah, you have to just stay, insist on staying calm, full stop in the wow. So it's affirmations like this, affirmations, wow, full stop in the wow, then more affirmations, more full stop in the wow. And it's that simple. It's that simple. This is wowism, which is a new religion. Religion has to do with practice. There's no practice, there's no religion, really. Got to practice, practice, practice. Theory without practice is it won't get you there. Just to say, yeah, okay, this is theoretically, this is it. But the self-mockery is so severe, we have to turn the tide and actually state the truth about ourselves. And reach that citadel, reach that impregnable citadel of silence. Realizing we don't need a bit of nature to feel totally sweet. So the silence, the complete absence of any effort to complete what we are, that's where the sweetness is. That's where the total sweetness is. This has nothing to do with bodies, nothing to do with nature, nothing to do with any of that. It's the inherency of what we are, the absolute freedom of what we are. It's the inherency of it, the inherent completeness of what we are, the unassailable completeness of what we are, totally unassailable. Can absolute freedom be trapped? It cannot. So it's unassailable. And this feeling of unassailableness, you know, is the natural feeling. Our natural feeling is a total sweetness. Losing that feeling as you're young. Oftentimes you feel really sweet, this feeling of sweetness when you're, and you get older and you start to lose it. I remember I said, my gosh, what happened to it? Where'd it go? So I started eating a bunch of sweets and honey. I used to eat sugar and honey. I said, how do I get the sweetness back? I used to just like drink honey. But really, I get these big containers of honey and I just like drink it like water. I'm trying to feel sweet. I said, what's the sweetest thing? Honey. So okay, let me get the honey. As like, this shows us how confused we get and how desperate we get. But to say that truth is mockery, is to mock truth. You know, that is a mocking of truth. You can say that, but it's so silly. It's a mockery, isn't it? That is mockery. That's what mockery says. Oh, the mockery says, we're not mocking you. Truth is mocking us. To say that truth is mocking mockery, that itself is a mockery of truth. This needs to be understood. This needs to be understood. trying to stay with fruits and nuts, as on my diet. Fruits and nuts, fruits and nuts. Just sort of as an external reminder, maybe, of be spiritually hydrated. Don't eat a bunch of fried, fatty, you know, foods, making a mockery of our diet, you know, the way we eat and overeat and all this sugary stuff. Be careful with natural sugar, low glycemic indexes, and we got this pulverizer, Nutribullet, which just like pulverizes and makes these super smooth, the purees of just about anything. Purees all the seeds, purees everything, and you just drink it like a smoothie. Yeah, not too exciting for sure. It tastes decent enough. Throw cranberry. They say to use water for it. I throw cranberry juice or cran apple, cran raspberry, cran lemon, cran lemonade, cran something mixtures. And that cranberry juice tends to form a very good base for any sort of smoothie. Very good. Drink the smoothies. It's very, it's easy. See, it's easy on your body. And so I think we need to go easy on our bodies right now because of this pressure to collapse into mockery and magical belief, where everyone believes that the more we mock what we are, truly are, the more advanced we are, the more progressive we are. You see, this is the progressives are very much into mocking Jesus, into mocking God, mocking spirit, mocking anything to do with religion. And they feel that they're very advanced in doing so. You see, that they're advanced in mockery is what they are. But they feel this is the answer. Because again, take your mockery seriously, you believe that what you're mocking must, that you end up thinking that you're not doing the mocking, it's what you're mocking, is that you're actually being mocked by truth. Truth is mocking you. So you're just defending yourself against the mockery or something. And this is, of course, again, more mockery. But they fail to see this. We all fail to see this. Being able to eat in a way that's really easily digestible for your body, that's not a burden to your system, may be really important to help us keep going during these times. Because if you're overloading your system with really hard to digest foods, you know, you could have a problem. It's possible. So I'll go in and I'm going to throw together some smoothie for the dinner, or soup, something like that. You know, soup, smoothies, soup, something that is easy to, in its most easily digestible form. That's what's coming in the world. We got the Nutribullet for Christmas, and trying to learn how to use it. It pulverizes everything into just this purees everything. You have to figure out how to use it because you don't want it too pulpy. You have to add liquid to keep it so it. You know, consistency is drinkable. Otherwise, they get going. I put apples in, turned into applesauce. Absolutely, he said, "Wow, it's good applesauce." We couldn't drink it, so then poured orange juice in, and then mix that up, or cranberry juice, and mix it up so it's drinkable. Not a bad investment. We have three basics, basic kitchen appliances that do everything. Microwave, powerful microwave, rotisserie, or turntable microwave, powerful microwave, a Foreman grill. Got a slightly larger one, so not, you can use a smaller one too, but the next size up, Foreman grill, and NutriBullet. Those three things are pretty much all you need. I actually do just virtually all cooking on that. The only thing don't cook on it is like if you cook an egg, put a little oil in a pan, cook the egg. Okay, those three things don't really cook an egg. I don't know. I guess you could, but so I guess you need if you eat eggs. But you could always poach an egg in the microwave, right? Just poach an egg, yeah. Or throw an egg in the smoothie. I haven't done that yet, but I probably will. That's the famous thing of bodybuilders. Put, you know, seven eggs in every, you know, the breakfast, they put like seven eggs in a smoothie with protein powder and everything. Hey, drink that. And that'll put some, you know, and they go work out and that'll build some muscle. Just relaxing here in the ambience of wow. Just standing up to self-mockery here, which is super wow. It's a super wow. What we do is we underestimate the wow. We underestimate, here's a problem that I'm trying to bring to light. We don't realize how long we have been enslaved to the self-mockery and how bitter it's been, because we keep thinking that this life, this body, and this is the only life we've had. And so we say, well, it can't be that bad. So we totally underestimate how severe the continuity fear is and how severe the wow is, how extreme it is, when we catch even a little glimpse of freedom, how just incredibly, you know, almost overcome we are with just, you know, just imagine it's been enslaved for eons in the most horrible fear, thinking that truth is dead, that God is dead, that our self doesn't exist anymore. And then to see that this is a little glimpse, this is not true. This is just such a huge deal to us. It is a huge deal to us. And if we think this is the only life we've had, it's like, oh, I was just born, I've only been living for a little while, and so, yeah, it's been terrible, but you know, it can't be that big of a deal, whatever. Then what happens is we underestimate the wow. We underestimate the severity of the continuity fear, so we say, I don't need to practice. And then we underestimate the wow, saying, well, it can't be that big of a deal for me, success. Totally underestimate it, and we fail. So, one place where I would assert at least my perspective up here is saying that the realization that we have lived many, many times, many, many forms, we've been going through this for a long, long time, you might even say eons of mockery, self-mockery, for so long, that it is a huge deal to start seeing light at the end of the tunnel. Way more than we realize. And so this is what I'm bringing here. This is why I have this focus on wowism instead of just going along with some other teachings. No, because I see this very clearly. It's super important. This is why we fail. This is why we fail. We give up because we underestimate the severity of the continuity problem and underestimate the potency of the wow. It's such a big deal to us, and we don't think it is that big of a deal. And so we take our eye off the prize, and we start feeling like, oh my gosh, why am I feeling this way? Oh, my practice must not be working, you know, and then we give up. So I keep reiterating the importance of this, and have we been engaged in self-mockery more than just this lifetime? Absolutely we have. In fact, we have been doing it for so much that really it's almost as if we completely believed our own mockery, self-mockery, you know, We can't completely agree with it, but we seem to completely agree with it, you know, and accept it. That's how long we've been doing it. That's how intensely we've been engaged in it. So, of course, we have a very serious problem. Not a little one. See, Taoism is putting things in the right perspective. Saying, I have a very severe continuity problem. Of course, if you think you only lived this one life, how can you have a severe continuity problem? It doesn't say that people say it's ridiculous. So I have a very severe continuity problem, and that is the confession of repentance, mood of repentance. It was the only problem I have. It's the only real problem I have, quote unquote real, pragmatically. So it's the only real problem I have. None of those other problems have any meaning for me, don't exist. They're not really problems at all. Because if it weren't for the severe continuity problem, I wouldn't hesitate to drop all self-mockery instantly. So the real problem I have, the only real problem I have is the continuity problem, and it's very, very severe. This is the fundamental confession of Taoism. And from that, then the mood of repentance sets in, and you're able to practice. Because you say, hey, I'm not going to just give up just because I don't succeed right away. And then the second part is full stop in the wow, realizing, hey, this is such a big deal to me. It's a bigger deal than I realize. I need to really acknowledge this, that this is, I'm overcome by just overreactive, just such a big deal to actually even start practicing at all is such a big deal. Just to take the step of starting to practice is such an enormous deal, because you thought you'd never be able to do this, literally. We those who are deep into self-mockery, they believe they'll never ever be able to even take the first step to try to get free of it. They're trapped forever, they believe. So just the beginning of practice is such an enormous deal. The wow is so huge around that it's difficult to start, because you may start and then quit. You say, I feel shocked, I feel stunned, I don't feel that great. This is the wow. This is such a big deal. The wow is so intense. You can't, don't quit that, you see. So I've just been looking at the world, observing it very carefully, and this is what I see. Why we don't succeed, why very few, not so many have succeeded, is they overlook this dynamic of the severity of the continuity problem and the intensity of the wow. Even just a little practice brings us this intense wow. Like, am I really even doing this? I didn't think this is possible. It's like so revolutionary. You know, you're turning against the terrible oppression of self-mockery and stating, in even a feeble little voice, you know, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Just say at one time, you stood up against the whole evil empire of self-mockery. And this is just tremendous. It's just tremendous. For you, for us, it's a big deal, a huge deal. And I love Jesus because he's so reassuring and gentle and kind, and tells us it is a big deal. He says, just do this. You may not realize it is a huge deal. Just, you know. And so he certainly understands this, that even a little bit of practice is an enormous deal to us. It's an enormously big deal to us. And he's right. He's absolutely right. So listening to this video is a big deal. Making this video is a huge deal. Standing up to the oppression of the evil empire of self-mockery is a gigantic deal. And it's just, and be able to do it really strongly is just, you know, it's just wow. And for me, it hits me. It hits me. And it's a big strain to go this fast. It really is. Recognize the strain, accept it's a wow, and be positive about it. Say, this is great, this is great. Yeah, I feel a little tired, this is great. And let yourself, you know, recover a little bit, and then keep going, because the conflagration of drought-stricken, spiritually drought-stricken entities that are believing they need this self-mockery to exist, you know, look out for a very severe tempest in terms of cloud. collapsing into compliance, demanding compliance that we all engage in severe self-mockery in order to even exist, right? In order to even exist, in order to be right, you know, in order to be, we have to adhere to practice, I call it, just to use a term, just to, you know, we can use no terminology, which is fine. If you don't like terminology, drop it. That's fine. It's even better, you know. But sometimes when the conflagration gets so severe, when there's so much pressure, we want to be able to hold on to something, some identity, even if it's a label, can help. So I say, Wowist. I'm a Wowist. I'm a Wowist. It's just a way of grabbing hold, you know, a little life raft of some definition. When we feel like we've been pulled down into total self-mockery, it's difficult to remain completely abstract. For many, it may be difficult. Some may not have any need for to say anything at all. But yeah. But you know, or you can say, you know, I'm a Wowist. I practice full stop in the Wow. I practice a Wowism. Now, what's your religious teaching belief? Wowism is, what is this? It's a totally pragmatic. What is Wowism? Practice. That's what it is. Practice. So my belief is practice these affirmations and then full stop in the Wow. That's it. It's that simple. So some may need this going forward. So I just put up a website and just at least a little bit of identity that way, you know, can be helpful for some. For others, no, don't need it. That's great too. Okay, before I freeze out here, I've got a lot of layers here, so I haven't quite frozen yet, but okay, remember, full stop in the Wow. If you've watched this video, this is heavy, heavy stuff. It is heavy, heavy song of liberation. You know, very heavy song of liberation. And that's a really big deal. Don't underestimate it. Very great. That's it.